these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. The United States Declaration of Independence, 1776. Africans imported as slaves and their descendants, slaves or free, are not citizens of the United States and can claim none of the rights provided by the Constitution. The United States Supreme Court, 1857. That cracked plate was enough to evoke the wrath of my master, who horsewhipped my poor mother unmercifully, far more severely than I ever knew him to whip a horse. Austin Stewart, child slave. From 12 years old, when he sees a slave boy his own age beaten with an iron shovel, John Brown will be haunted by the cries of those in bondage. He will spend a lifetime watching his country compromise with the evil of slavery, one unjust law after the next. Salmon Brown, the eighth of John Brown's children, recalls, "My early recollections go back clearly to the old home in Hudson, Ohio. Father would sit in front of a lively fire and take up us children, one, two, or three at a time, and sing until bedtime. We all loved to hear him sing, as well as to talk to the conditions of the country, over which he seemed worried. A favorite song with Father and us children was Blow Ye the Trumpet Blow." Blow ye the trumpet blow, throughout the world proclaim, let all the nations know, be free in Jesus' name. The year of Jubilee is come, the year of Jubilee is come, return ye ransomed sinners home. John Brown's eldest daughter, Ruth, recalls, "On fast days and Thanksgivings, he used to very often to read the 58th chapter of Isaiah. Is it not the fast that I have chosen, saith the Lord?" To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Ye slaves of sin and hell, your liberty receive. Ye weary spirits, rest. Be mournful, sins have gleaned. November 1836. The Congregational Church, Hudson, Ohio, following a stirring anti-slavery sermon after the shooting death in Illinois of abolitionist publisher Elijah Lovejoy, a 37-year-old John Brown rises to his feet. Here before God, in the presence of these witnesses, from this time, of slavery. After several years of sheltering fugitive slaves, John Brown, now 55 years old, moves his family to Kansas so he can vote against allowing slavery into the new state. His son, Salmon, recalls of the journey. Near Independence, Missouri, we saw a slave pen built like a chicken coop, only stronger and higher. Inside the pen was the auction block. This slave selling stirred my father to the depths of his soul. This will become known as the Potawatomi Massacre. Autumn, 1859. John Brown has been able to assemble only 21 men willing to join his daring plan to free the slaves. Brown's friend, abolitionist Fredrick Douglass, has warned Brown he will never get away from Harper's Ferry alive. But John Brown is resolute, believing only action, not talk, and put an end to slavery. October 16, 1859. Under the darkness, John Brown leads his men into Harper's Ferry. The Federal Arsenal Fall Watchman is taken by surprise, and John Brown captures 100,000 guns without firing a shot. Brown's men take several hostages, including the great-grand-nephew of George Washington. Not one of the hostages will be harmed. Brown's second-in-command urges Brown to flee with the captured weapons and establish a mountain stronghold as planned. But oddly, Brown is reluctant to leave. His hesitation will prove fatal. The Charlestown militia arrives, drinking whiskey. Several of Brown's men are killed trying to escape. Their bodies are used for target practice. Brown's son Watson is shot down while under a red flag. Dispatches a unit of United States Marines under the command of a colonel by the name of Robert E. Lee. Lee's lieutenant is a 26-year-old West Point graduate known as Jeb Stuart. Lee's forces arrive. The assault is over in less than 3 minutes. John Brown is wounded by a saber thrust and blow to the head. These are the words John Brown speaks in his defense at the trial. Had I suffered and sacrificed what I had at Harper's Ferry in behalf of the rich, the powerful, and the so-called great, every man in this court would have deemed it an act worthy of reward rather than punishment. I see a Bible here that teaches me that I should do unto others as I would have them to do unto me, and to remember that they are in bonds as bound with them. I endeavor to act on that instruction in behalf of the millions in this slave country whose rights are disregarded by wicked, cruel, and unjust act. I think you are guilty, my friends, of a great wrong against God and humanity, and it would be perfectly right for anyone to interfere with you so far as to free those you willfully and wickedly hold in bondage. You may dispose of me very easily, but this slave question is still to be settled. The end of that is not yet. December 2nd, 1859, John Brown was hung today. He behaved with unflinching firmness and ascended to the scaffold with apparent cheerfulness. fro. Thomas Stonewall Jackson, eyewitness. Is but a small moment. I feel just as content to die for God's eternal truth and for suffering humanity on the scaffold as in any other way. Do not any of you grieve for a single moment on my account, as I trust my life has not been thrown away. So as I humbly trust that my death will not be in vain. God can make my death 1,000 times more valuable to his own cause than the service that I have rendered it during my life. Your affectionate husband and father, John Brown.